Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Tomasz Wolinski, and I'm a product and marketing manager at RF Elements, and I'll be taking you through this webinar today. But before we start, let me mention that we co-organize this webinar with Miro Distribution, which is a distributor of wireless networking equipment in South Africa. So if you're located there, make sure to contact them. They're our official distributor in South Africa. Let's go to the product overview. So our product range covers antennas, which we'll speak of the most today. And at the end, I'll shortly look at the integration platforms, which might be also interesting for you. So this product map you see shows our antennas organized according to the beam shape and connector interface. And the beam shape is changing in a vertical direction. Yeah, so the symmetrical antennas are in the top two lines, and asymmetrical ones below in the third line. And in the horizontal direction, the gain is changing from left to right. So at the left, at the very left, you have the 90 degrees symmetrical horn with around 9.6 dBi gain. And on the right, you have the Ultradish with 27 dBi gain. And of course, we also added the new products you might be interested in hearing about the most, actually, and that's the starter products, the starter horn and three starter dishes. Before we go to the antennas themselves, though, I will speak about the twist port and twist port adapters, which are displayed in the bottom line, and now you can see them zoomed in, to help you understand what are the advantages of twist port compared to traditional coaxial connectors and interface in general. So twist port is RF Elements' own proprietary waveguide connector that connects the radio with an antenna. That's its main and bottom line function. But it has two essential advantages. So first, because it's a waveguide connector, twist port introduces practically zero loss into the system. And that's very important to achieve excellent RF performance, which means in practice that the power the radio gives out is really reaching the antenna. And nothing is lost in the cables as it usually is when you use pigtails. And the second advantage is that twist port combines the radio mounting and RF connection into a single and easy to use interface. It's extremely safe and easy to operate. So you don't have to attach the radio to the tower separately. And the twist port actually mounts and connects the radio at the same time. And when you insert the radio and twist it in, it locks automatically and stays mounted. And unlocking is equally easy, as you can see from the animation. Just twist the outer ring and reverse the movement, and the radio is released. In our reference radio design, which we designed back in 2014, we removed the coaxial cables or pigtails completely and integrated the twist port male connector directly into the circuit board of the radio. So the radio can be attached to any twist port antenna while introducing practically zero loss. Now, we consider twist port truly revolutionary interface, which introduces a whole new ecosystem built around the advantages of the waveguide itself and excellent mechanical design, which enables easy connection with virtually zero loss RF performance. The twist port adapter solves a simple task. It converts the coaxial radio interface of third-party radios into twist port male interface. And the adapter enables intuitive connection of both the radio and the antenna. And again, it's very easy to use and has very low loss, which is practically immeasurable. So you can see on the animation what is inside of a typical twist port adapter. And the coaxial cables that connect the waveguide to the waveguide feed to the radio connectors are semi-rigid. And they are high-quality semi-rigid cables integrated in the adapter body. Now, because of this, you don't need to bend, connect, or disconnect and constantly handle the cables over and over, which results into a very stable and lasting performance. And that semi-rigid shielding also stabilizes their performance, yeah, because they don't, there's absolutely no movement of those cables at all. And the rest of the twist port adapter body is designed to accommodate the most popular radios used in WISP networks. Since most radios have different body shape, we have several twist port adapters to fit them naturally. And the twist port adapters have three types of connection on the side of the radio. So first is the most common radio interface of WISP radios, which is a pair of SMA connectors. So the radios with coaxial output are connected to the corresponding twist port adapter by sliding in and radio until the radio clicks in and locks in place, as you saw. Second, which you see right now, is the radios with the waveguide connector, yeah, or waveguide output. And assembling a few parts together converts a third-party waveguide connector to twist port male connector. And finally, many of the Mikrotik radios come as a bare printed circuit board, yeah, without any enclosure, in which case you need to insert the whole PCB into our adapter to make it work, but nevertheless, it works equally well. Again, very simple, insert in, and you have the male twist port adapter connector at the output. And it is important to emphasize that any twist port adapter works with every twist port antenna. So twist port adapters are specific on the side of the radio because of the different shapes of these third-party radios, but on the side of the antenna, there's always the same twist port connector, which is compatible with any twist port antenna. So once you have the right adapter for the radio you have, you're all set and you can connect it with any twist port antenna. And we have adapters for four major radio brands in WISP industry. Yeah, so Ubiquiti, Cambium, Mimosa, and Mikrotik radios. So let's have a look at which radios are compatible with which adapters. For Ubiquiti, we have four adapters. So the TPA path, the top left corner, yeah, is compatible with the Rocket Prism 5AC, the 5AC Gen 2, Air Fiber 5X, 5X HD, and LTU Rocket. So this adapter is compatible with five different radios. The older Rocket M5 works with the TPA RM5, and Rocket 5AC Lite works with the TPA R5AC. And the twist port adapter for the ISO station in the lower left corner is compatible with the waveguide radios from Ubiquiti, meaning the ISO station M5, Prism station, and ISO station 5AC. For Cambium, we have two adapters. So the TPA EPMP and TPA Adapt E2K. So the top one, which is the TPA EPMP, is compatible with the EPMP 1000, both the client and the access point version, as well as the EPMP 3000L access point and the Force 300 CSM. The lower one, the bigger one, the TPA Adapt E2K, works with the EPMP 2000, as well as the new EPMP Force 400C, which is the recently released 802.11ax radio from Cambium. For Mimosa radios, we have twist port adapter for the Mimosa C5C, which is on the left side. In the middle, you have the adapter for the Mimosa C5X, their waveguide-based radio. And on the right side, we show the adapter for the Mimosa A5X, one of the newest radios from Mimosa. For those of you who are using the Mikrotik radios, we have the TPA RBP, which is on the bottom line, yeah, which has a plastic body. And the TPA RBC in the top line has a full metal body, yeah, that basically offers better protection of the radio from changing weather and outside conditions and RF noise. But both are compatible with the same router boards, yeah, meaning the router board 4, 7, and 9 series, as well as the M11. And finally, if you have a radio that we did not mention in these slides, you don't need to worry. For third-party radios for which we don't offer a custom matching adapter, we have the connectorized twist port adapter, which is available obviously with two SMA connectors, and you can connect it to anything you like and anything that has a coaxial output. And we realized this is a lot to remember. Now, all those adapters we just went through quite quickly can be quite difficult to keep in mind, but don't worry. We prepared a little help for you for a quick reference on our webpage. In the download section, you can download the twist port adapter compatibility sheet as a PDF. Yeah, so you can print it out or just keep it somewhere at hand at your desktop or in your phone, wherever is convenient for you. So horn sector antennas are by far the most effective technology to deal with RF noise in unlicensed 5 GHz networks. So let's have a look at a detailed explanation how. While the traditional patch array sectors radiates pretty much in every direction, which you can see on the right side animation, yeah, you can see that the waves going away from the antenna are really going everywhere. Yeah. Horn, on the other hand, radiates the energy only in the direction of the main lobe. And this is the essential advantage of horns. There's zero side lobes radiation pattern. Now, since the side lobes collect and transmit the noise, getting rid of the side lobes means you get rid of the noise. It's that simple. But, you know, just saying that an antenna has zero side lobes is somewhat vague, of course. It is like saying, you know, quote unquote, well, I drove very fast, instead of saying I drove 200 kilometers per hour. There's quite a difference there, which of course we all understand. So is there a measure of the amount of side lobes an antenna has? Well, indeed, there is. It's beam efficiency. So beam efficiency is the ratio of the energy contained in the main lobe to the total energy an antenna radiates. In other words, it says what part of the radiated energy is going into the main lobe. So the higher the beam efficiency is, the less side lobes an antenna has. So the maximum value of beam efficiency is 100%, which is the best case, yeah, where 100% of the power antenna radiates is in the main lobe. Whereas the closer to 0%, the beam efficiency is, the more side lobes an antenna has. So naturally, you want to have your antennas to have as high beam efficiency as possible. And beam efficiency makes the comparison of two antennas in terms of side lobe performance extremely easy. The higher number wins. It's that simple. In this example, the symmetrical horn has beam efficiency of 94%. A typical patch array sector has beam efficiency of 69%. So the remaining 31% of the energy it radiates and receives is noise to someone else or higher noise floor for the radio it is connected to. So the 94% is clearly more than 69%, yeah, which makes symmetrical horn much better antenna in terms of noise suppression. And using high beam efficiency antenna is essential for sustainable 5 GHz unlicensed networks or any other unlicensed frequency bands for that matter. It's really not specific to the 5 GHz. It's really mostly about the fact that the frequency band might be unlicensed, in which case anybody can deploy as many devices as they want. And then it's just a question of time when it's going to be saturated with noise. So in which cases, it really makes sense to use antennas with as high beam efficiency as possible. And the rest of our horn sector antennas are no worse at all. In fact, the average beam efficiency across all our horns is 93%. And the Ultrahorn, for example, has beam efficiency 99%, which really makes it the best antenna in terms of noise suppression on the WISP market, in our opinion. And using high beam efficiency antennas protects your network from RF noise better than any other solution on the WISP market. The patch array sectors are problematic when it comes to collocation as well. You see a gradual decline of the network throughput and stability with every new patch array sector added until you arrive at a point where even one more additional sector, either yours or competitors, it really doesn't matter. It really kills the site completely. Yeah, the network throughput halts, and you have to troubleshoot very quickly. Now, with horns, this problem is practically non-existent. The zero silo pattern enables predictable, dense collocations without any degradation of the network performance. Since they don't have any side lobes, they do not collect or transmit the noise to the surroundings. So how densely can you collocate horns? And you get a loud and clear answer seeing these images, like really densely. So many sectors on one side are only possible when using horns. Now, no traditional sector technology will let you do this kind of deployment, which also perform greatly at the same time with high aggregate throughput, really corresponding to the sum of the maximum throughput of all the radios on the tower. The frequency stability of the radiation pattern of horn is really unmatched. You can see it changing a little bit with the frequency, but the resulting change of the coverage area is negligible. So the frequency stability is a factor that is important for connection stability when changing the channels. And with horns, there is practically no change in the coverage throughout the useful spectrum. Most patch array sector antennas, though, have many side lobes. And unfortunately, also the main lobe that change with frequency quite substantially. Now, this results into fluctuating coverage of a sector perceived throughout the whole sector, and especially by the customers at the edges of the sector as unstable throughput. So the maximum gain further illustrates the stability of horns. The gain curve is almost completely flat with horns in general, which is represented by the green curve in this graph. With a traditional sector, the gain changes drastically within the same frequency band, which is really undesirable. It only underlines the frequency instability we shown on the previous slide for the patch array sectors. And on top of that, the gain of the patch array is sort of, okay, within much narrower bandwidth. Yeah. So horns, on the contrary, have a wide frequency range in which the gain is nearly ideally flat. Yeah. And unlike any antenna technology on the WISP market, RF Elements horns offer a unique toolset of 11 different antennas that let you optimize the coverage you provide regardless of the customer density or distribution, really. The denser the sector is with the customers, the narrower beamwidth you want to use, and vice versa. And the lower customer density areas can be covered with a wider beamwidth horns if the customer distribution allows it, of course. And with horns, you have a wide variety of tools that lets you react to any situation with the right tool. And all the favorable properties of horn technology enable unlimited scalability of 5 GHz wireless networks. Because if a sector performs reliably and with the minimum noise, and you can keep adding more and more sectors without degrading the performance of those that are already in place, you have won. I mean, you can plan your network coverage with the precision and with all the horns at hand, sky is really the limit, and on how big your network can be. So this is the core of the functionality of our technology. Yeah? It's the sustainable and fast wireless. Compared to the traditional patch array sector antenna with a very narrow beam in the elevation plane, horns can have a symmetrical beam, meaning that it has the same width in the azimuth and elevation planes. Asymmetrical horns radiation pattern combines the best of the horn and patch array sectors. So the shape of the main beam is similar to the patch array, meaning that the beam width is narrower in the elevation plane, but at the same time, it has the zero side lobes as all our horns do. With the traditional patch array sectors, it is really hard to cover the areas near the site. With horns, both symmetrical and asymmetrical, this problem is practically non-existent. Thanks to the extra beam width in the elevation plane the horns offer, the coverage of areas near the tower is automatic, regardless of the landscape type. This difference is the most obvious actually in the mountainous areas, where the traditional patchery sectors fail almost completely because of their narrow elevation beam width. But horns do just fine, again, thanks to that wider radiation pattern in the elevation plane. And you might be kind of wondering about that, yeah? Because you might be used to the shape of the radiation pattern of those traditional patch array sectors being really, really narrow. And now we're showing you this like really strange radiation patterns, which are really wide in the elevation. But, you know, given this explanation, that symmetrical radiation pattern is really an advantage. It's nothing to be worried about, nothing to be afraid of. It's actually an advantage and a tool in your hands. The down tilt is a huge factor influencing the coverage area with patch array sectors. Now you can see anything beyond a few degrees down tilt makes the patch array practically useless. Now you completely lose the coverage of the distant areas. And only at a few degrees of down tilt. Now with horns, the down tilt is an additional functionality. Yeah. So the coverage area smoothly shrinks while maintaining its shape. So changing the down tilt, you can dynamically change the sector coverage as you wish, as well as, you know, decrease the level of noise, actually. The bigger the down tilt, the less noise you see, provided you're, of course, still covering the customers, which is the first concern, of course. And our link calculator, accessible on our webpage, is actually the best tool to figure out what the down tilt should be, because you might be wondering, well, with the traditional sectors, you just set the down tilt to, you know, some predetermined fixed value of like 1, 2, or 3 degrees, whatever that is, and you just leave it be. But with horns, you have the option. It's actually a functionality, meaning that, you know, you should choose the down tilt wisely. And again, the best tool to figure out our down tilt is the down tilt you need to use is our link calculator, where you can actually play with the down tilt and see how the coverage changes and adjust it depending on where your user base is. The size of the horns makes their installation easy, even on crowded sites, and actually might even save you the fees for the tower rental, depending on where you're based. Now, with their size being a fraction of traditional patch array sector, you can fit more sectors in the same place. And that's really great feature, right? Because it really lets you, or it gives you a lot more space, you know, to increase the overall throughput of your sites. The 30 degree asymmetrical horn has a beam switch feature. Yeah, so as you see from the animation, when you swap the position of the handle and the bracket, the radiation pattern rotates as well, naturally. So you can switch from 30 degrees to 20 degrees as you move beam width, in case you need to narrow down the sector you're covering. So the beam switch basically makes 30 degree asymmetrical horn two antennas in one. I mean, the gain doesn't change, but you can change the beam width in the azimuth plane. So the narrowing of the sector might be useful when your customer density in areas really grows. So you wanna narrow down and cover less customers because the radio cannot take the growing customer base anymore. So you just divide the sector into more narrower ones. And the 30 degree asymmetrical horn lets you do that just by flipping the position of the bracket and the handle. Our bracket is extremely sturdy and simple at the same time. So we minimize the number of parts that are needed to mount our antennas with absolutely no compromise to the strength of the attachment, its durability, and actually ease of use as well. So besides that, the stainless steel bolts that are needed to attach the bracket have black colored anti-seize coating. So they will last very long without corrosion. And at the same time, they won't seize on you thanks to that decreased friction coefficient, thanks to, well, you know, it's simple. You recognize the bolts by the black color, which is the color of that anti-seize coating that helps to prevent their seizing. And we have minimized the number of bolts to the essential amount that ensures stable and reliable antenna mounting. So 2 to mount the bracket, 2 to secure the azimuth, and 2 for the elevation. Now, all of these except the black colored ones are pre-installed as you buy the antenna or as you take it from the package. So you don't need to handle them or worry that you lose them while climbing a tower or anything like that. And the angle measures are engraved on the mount itself, which makes them easy to read and align the antennas with the 5-degree steps. Our antennas are built to last. We use high quality die-cast, stamped or extruded aluminium, stainless steel hardware, and UV resistant plastic, so you can deploy horns in all kinds of climates and weather conditions with the guarantee of durability. And we choose the materials with emphasis on quality and durability while at the same time maintaining a reasonable price. Horns give you freedom. Yeah, give you freedom to use a suitable tool for any situation. Something you might have not been used to if you mainly relied on the traditional patch or resectors until now. But it is the freedom to take advantage of. So take an example in the middle. The symmetrical horn for dense customer area on the top, the asymmetrical horn on the bottom for less dense area with customers further apart and maybe further away from the site, and our patch or resector in the middle for the very low density customer base. Wonderful use case of all three types of antennas on one side for optimal coverage. Super dense sectors you can see here are no exception for horns. And these are images from our customers, and all these sectors provide excellent and stable performance, something you can really only achieve with horns. Or distant narrow sectors with 3 ultra horns, which you can see on the right. There is absolutely nothing to worry about when deploying dense clusters of horns. They're simply effortless. So with horns, you have 2 main options of how to connect your radios. Let's have a look. You can choose horns with twist port, our proprietary waveguide connector with practically zero loss and super easy installation and removal of the radio using one hand. And the advantage of twist port horns is extremely easy swapping of the radio or migration to other platforms. If you choose to do that in the future, maybe you won't be happy with one radio brand and you simply want to switch. And the twist port horns enable you to do that very easily. Now you just need to swap the adapter and that's it. However, you may prefer the female end connector interface, which is a traditional coaxial interface for cases when, for some reason, using twist port is not an option. And the antennas are identical to the twist port ones from the RF point of view, with the same gain, the same beam width. The only difference is at the connector interface. Yeah, that's all. So let's go to our horn accessories now. The twin horn bracket lets you mount 2 symmetrical horns of any beam width with the same aiming, regardless if it is a twist port or the carrier class version. So the twin horn bracket comes with an improved mounting bracket, which is really sturdy, and a comfortable handle, which you can easily clip to a carabiner and to a harness. So it's safely attached to as you're climbing up the tower. And the twin horn bracket has 2 default options for radio mounting: the 4-channel Cambium Networks EPMP 3000 and Mimosa A5C. And the bracket to mount them is directly in the package. So the twin horn bracket makes high density sectors easy to align since the horns automatically aim in the same direction. So with the twin horn bracket, you can leverage the 4x4 MIMO setups. You can also use twin horn bracket with two radios with twist port adapters, for example, if you choose to, and use one sector as a backup, maybe. Twin horn bracket really gives you many options on how to use it. The combination of antennas, adapters, and interfaces is almost endless. But if you're interested in a complete compatibility list, you should check the webpage of the product on rfelements.com. And now we come to our parabolic dish antennas. So Ultradish is directional parabolic dish antenna for 5 gigahertz unlicensed bands with optimized side load performance. It comes in 3 sizes, with 21, 24, and 27, where the numbers correspond to the gain of the dishes. And they're available and sold in convenient 2-packs. The radiation pattern of Ultradish provides high gain that is needed for long distance links and suppressed side lobes for increased noise immunity. Now, with a dish as a type of an antenna, it is really not possible to avoid the side lobes completely. But by thoroughly optimizing the antenna design, it is possible to suppress the side lobes, which results into improved performance of the Ultradish when compared to the competitive products. And the improved performance of Ultradish offers, is possible without the need to install any additional shielding in the form of a shroud. So no aftermarket shielding kits are needed with Ultradish for really great performance. And the useful bandwidth of the Ultradish covers 1300 megahertz of the unlicensed spectrum from Uni 1 all the way up to the Uni 5. Yeah, which gives you plenty of space to optimize your links by being able to switch between the channels and use the cleanest one. Now, the wide useful spectrum is yet another tool that lets you avoid the noise and deliver reliable service to your customers. Now, when leveraging that wide frequency range by switching between the different channels, you want the antenna to have a stable performance, such that the signal strength does not change. And this is exactly what the Ultradish antennas enable. Now, thanks to the gain that is stable over the whole useful bandwidth. Now, on top of that, this is valid actually for both the horizontal and vertical polarizations, which is why you only see 3 curves in this graph. The horizontal and vertical gain curves are actually overlapping for each of these antennas. So stability of gain results in a stable and reliable link operation. Ultradish is suitable for areas with high surrounding noise levels. Now, typically those are most of the urban and suburban areas. Now, Ultradish delivers highly focused beam suppressing the surrounding noise. Unlike the traditional patch arrays directional patch array sectors that radiate practically in every direction, resulting into unwanted noise collection by the CPE radio, a cleaner radiation pattern of the Ultradish, on the other hand, eliminates the unwanted connections to the multiple access points and suppresses the noise at the same time. Ultradish is equipped with the UBR, our bulletproof bracket design. It is made of really massive extruded aluminum profiles, and it is brilliantly easy to work with. Now, only 2 bolts are needed to mount the bracket on the tower, and that's it. The 2 bolts have the black colored surface coating, as we mentioned before, which protects them from seizing, while at the same time, it enables a long lifetime of the whole bracket, thanks to the stainless steel they're made of. An optional radome for the 27 dBi Ultradish is made of high quality materials as well to provide long lasting protection of the antenna from the weather conditions. And it actually also offers somewhat decreased wind load as well. And here are some examples of the Ultradish deployments. They're being used in the point-to-point or CPE applications as well. Now, if you check our social media channels, whether it's YouTube, I mean, Facebook or Instagram, you will see much more of these installation popping up regularly from our customers. Let's now go to the starter products. Our antenna series that offers improved RF performance at a very attractive pricing. Starter antennas include four products: starter horn, which is an access point antenna, and three starter dishes for CPE applications in the 5 GHz unlicensed bands. So they are meant for WISPs who are starting with RF elements products, as the name suggests, as well as for those who want to benefit from great RF performance but are not ready yet to enter our Twistport ecosystem, or just don't need that immense scalability options the Twistport symmetrical horn ecosystem offers. And there are a few limitations with the starter products, and one of them being the connectivity options. So it's good to be aware of those. You can connect the starter antennas with radios that have coaxial interface or waveguide interface of common radio brands. Now, these connectivity options are supported out of the box, so you don't need to purchase any additional adapters. Starter horn 30 is a 30-degree beamwidth and 18 dBi gain symmetrical horn with all the benefits that come with it, which we discussed before. Yeah, the symmetrical beam, zero side lobes, stable gain, stable radiation pattern, and so on. The starter horn is an access point antenna. So by replacing the patch array sector with a huge frequency-dependent side lobes by starter horn, you'll get a stable and reliable throughput improvement thanks to zero side lobes radiation pattern, along with minimized fluctuation of the sector performance. Starter horn primarily offers coaxial SMA interface, so you can connect any third-party radio with SMA or any other coaxial interface for that matter, with, of course, the right interconnecting reduction. On top of that, removing the SMA adapter, you can plug in the Ubiquiti waveguide radios directly as well. The materials used to make starter horn are high-quality die-cast and extruded aluminum, UV-resistant plastic, and stainless steel, with the hardware for the great weather performance. I mean, resistance, sorry, because of course stainless steel lasts much longer. And the bracket is a simple V-bolt profile that lets you mount the starter horn poles with diameters between 20 and 55 millimeters, provided you change the bracket position and orientation when necessary. So besides the wireless industry, we equally care about the planet. So we progressively are reducing the use of plastic in our packaging as much as possible and replace it with recyclable cardboard to decrease the carbon footprint of our antenna production. And starter dishes are parabolic dishes for 5 GHz unlicensed band for CPE applications. Now they offer a great RF performance with suppressed side lobes, and they come with attractive pricing for and compact packages of five. Yeah, so the three gain options give you a lot of space to optimize your links. So the 21 dBi starter dish for short distances, 27 for the long one, and the 24 for anything in between. Starter dish is suitable as a client antenna in areas with high surrounding noise level. Suburban and city environments where minimizing the noise at the side of the client also adds to improved user experience thanks to the suppressed side lobes. And again, instead of using a directional patch array with lots of side lobes, starter dish offers a great alternative to suppress the noise at attractive pricing. Mounting of the starter dish is a simple V-bolt bracket, just the same like with the starter horn, made of the same high-quality materials and with surface-coated stainless steel hardware and UV-resistant plastic. Starter dish offers two default radio connections. So the Ubiquiti waveguide connector and an adapter for Mimosa C5X, which is a waveguide radio as well. Now, the operation of both is equally simple. Insert and lock the radio in position with one hand. That's it. You can also purchase an optional SMA adapter to use with starter dishes, which obviously provides two SMA connectors. And a small disclaimer here. So just to make it completely clear to you, this adapter is not part of the starter dish package. It has to be purchased separately. But with the starter horn, this adapter is inside the package already. Now on to our patch array antennas. So if you should use a patch array antenna at all, it should be AS520 with 20 dBi gain and 100 degrees beamwidth at -6 decibels. This antenna is also designed to and optimized to work in unlicensed 5 gigahertz band. Array sector is patch array antenna equipped with our proprietary backshield. So backshield is frequency selective surface, and it is integrated in the antenna body. It is designed to effectively suppress the back radiation. So you do not need to use any additional shields or reflectors with these antennas. Everything is included in the package. Array sector is designed to have the same radiation pattern for both polarizations to ensure perfect coverage at the edges of the sector. And this is a very important feature for a sector antenna to deliver equal coverage in both horizontal and vertical polarizations. This graph is telling you that in the whole useful bandwidth from 5.1 to 5.9, the gain of our patch array sector is completely stable. And this is a feature truly unique and difficult to achieve with patch array antennas. Now, the stability of the gain is important for a reliable performance as you're switching between the channels. And the AS520 can easily be connected to many radios commonly used in WISP networks. With the standard bracket, all it takes to connect the radio is to slide it in until you hear a click sound and, you know, putting the hood on top of the interface to protect the cables. And finally, we will look at our offer of integration platforms. So the Station Box Alu Mini is a small form factor enclosure, which is suitable for many IoT or other wireless applications. Now, it is made of solid aluminium, so it protects your circuit board from the changing weather and RF noise. Now, the files for 3D printing of various insert boards that help you integrate the circuit boards are available for download on our webpage. So if you go to rfelements.com, there is a download section where you can find the 3D printing files. Station Box is very easy to install and connect. As you see from this animation, it is quick to attach to the holder and to the pole, and even faster to mount the Station Box onto it. And the bracket allows you to mount the Station Box on a wall as well. Besides that, the mounting bracket is made of aluminium, so it will last for a long time in all kinds of conditions and weather. Station Box Alu is our bigger integration platform that accommodates larger size boards or more smaller ones, really. It really depends up to you. These platforms are very flexible. The space inside the SBX Alu gives you a lot of options on how to use it. And this enclosure is made of die-cast aluminium, and the paint on the surface is UV-resistant, and the whole enclosure is offering the IP55 rating, so it will withstand and resist any weather conditions. And the plastic board with many options for the integration of the Mikrotik, Alex, or TP-Link boards, you know, for full compatibility list, you can check the data sheet of the product on our webpage. And you can mount the station box on a pole or a wall if you want, as well as the previous station box. So at RF Elements, we address the problem of RF noise by complete change of paradigm of fixed wireless industry. And we're setting new industry standards of RF performance, noise rejection, and system scalability. And we also listen to our customers, proof of which is our surface-coated stainless steel hardware, which used to cease to a number of customers, but now with the black surface coating, the seizing is history. And of course, we definitely try to preserve the planet as well. So again, I'll just repeat that our packaging is increasingly made of cardboard instead of the plastic to protect or do our part in saving the planet. And many of our customers are wondering where to buy our products, and they might not be sure. So on our webpage, there is directly on the landing page is the stock locator, which, you know, takes you to a page where after selecting the product you're looking for and your region, it will show you the list of the distributors that are nearest to you and who have that particular product in stock. One of the frequent questions our customers ask is, well, how far can I go with these horns? I mean, they have smaller gain than my sector that I'm using now. Well, the answer to this question is not simple because there is many parameters that influence the distance you can cover with any kind of antenna. So that's why the best tool to figure out how far these antennas can go and what coverage they provide is our link calculator. Again, on our webpage, rfelements.com, on the right side of the page, you can see this tab saying link calculator, which will take you to our tool that helps you figure out the answers you're looking for. And finally, I would like to invite you to join our online community if you're not part of it yet. So we have rflab.com, which is an online discussion forum, which is a great resource if you have any questions, if you're wondering about, well, how about this antenna? What can I use it with? Or I have this and that problem. The rflab.com is probably the best resource and the fastest one that will provide you the answers. Yeah, so we really check that forum daily. So make sure to register. And we also have a discussion group on Facebook called RF Elements English, which you can join as well. Many people are sharing their, for example, pictures from installations or even questions. So you can ask them also there. On our YouTube channel, you can check the playlist called Wisp Traveler, which is a series of short videos where we travel around the world and ask our customers how they benefited from from using our horn antennas. So of course we can talk to you all we want about how great our antennas are or are not, but ultimately it's the proof is in the pudding, right? So you definitely should, and I encourage you to check out these testimonials from our customers all around the world, which will tell you what was their experience, what problems they were facing, and how the horns have or have not helped in solving those. Another playlist I would like to bring your attention to is Inside Wireless. Again, on our YouTube channel, Inside Wireless is a series of short educational videos about all kinds of concepts and ideas from the world of RF engineering. So whether you're a seasoned veteran RF engineer or just starting out your WISP business, you know, these videos can be either a great refresher or a good base, to get you going, to clarify the basic ideas and really explain everything in a simple and understandable way. And quick, moreover, these videos are a few minutes on average. And finally, I just want to say that all the trademarks the names of the brands we use in the presentation, we just use to reference the compatibility with our products and nothing else. So I would just conclude the presentation and let's all have a nice rest of the day and week. Thank you and bye-bye.